none of you guys really know who I am as a painter, so I'll give a little bit of backstory. I came to LA in 2001 from New York, and mostly what I was doing as a painter is interior spaces. Some landscapes and figures along the way, but mostly I was enthralled with sort of natural light interiors, usually inspired from travel, where I would go to Europe or South America or China, wherever I went, get ideas for paintings, come back to LA and make the big work. Sometimes I'd paint abroad, sometimes I'd just, you know, take references and do drawings. And so I've always sort of had this fascination with especially empty interior spaces, kind of void of human presence, the human space but without the humanity in it. And for me, I was intrigued by this because it sort of was an invitation into the space as a sort of mental construction of your, maybe your headspace. So I've always also painted and drawn the figure on the side, occasionally showing work, but usually it was a secondary investigation. So a few years ago, I actually went back to graduate school after having been showing for years and years and years and teaching in graduate level and undergraduate painting. I decided to go back and get my MFA, but focusing exclusively on portraiture and the figure. Because I understood how to paint the figure and the portrait, but I wasn't sure exactly what I wanted to say with it. And so I just decided to dedicate 2 years to completely investigating the figure and in different techniques, varying approaches, not assuming I had all the answers, not assuming like this is my method of painting the figure. Like, no, I'm gonna kind of throw that out and question my own assumptions. These are sort of cliches in the art school world, of questioning your own assumptions and going in with eyes wide open. But the difference is I had 20 years of painting under my belt, so I could do whatever I wanted to do. So to question your assumptions is much more fun when you do that. You can play, you can break rules, and you know you can always wrestle the painting back into submission. So what you're looking at with the figurative work is totally different approaches to each one. Different intentions, different, completely a wide open approach in each picture. And the environments were often really important to me. There's a lot of great figure painters out there, but a lot of times they really just focus on the figure itself. And to me, the figure ground is really important. Figure ground relationship is something that I think can't be ignored if you're making a great picture. So in these paintings, the environments of people I know, friends in LA, models in the studio, self-portrait of me, the environments have to be crucial and integral to the piece. So I think the best thing I'll do is I'll just start talking about some of these pieces. And if you guys have specific questions, maybe hold them. And at the end, I'll answer whatever you guys throw at me, OK? Does that sound good? All right. This one is a painting of a singer in LA. Her name is Inara George. And she's a pretty well-known singer. She's daughter of a singer named Lowell George, who's the lead singer for Little Feat, remember that? And she's an incredible singer and an old friend. I've known her as an acquaintance ever since I've been in LA. And so I went to her house and I wanted to have an image of her sort of listening to music and captured in the act of listening and thinking about music and surrounded by a piano and her other items of musical importance. And this painting, I painted it pretty straightforwardly, and at some point I decided it was too boring, and I started breaking up the background and kind of scraping through all the horizontal linear elements of the picture, because I wanted to create a sort of like visual dissonance of the world around this figure, but her flesh is painted with a really slow, sticky turn of form. And this is a thing that occurred to me when actually I was looking at a Tiepolo in the National Gallery in DC, and Tiepolo has this really quick movement of paint, and I love that. I've always loved Rubens, oil sketches, and fast movements of paint, and that really kind of bravura, like sketchy nature of oil. And in the same painting, he had this sketchy nature of oil, and then this really slow, sticky turn of paint on the flesh, right next to each other. And he was definitely treating them with different mediums, different brushes, different attacks. And so I said, okay, if Tiepolo has to separate how he paints flesh and the cloth and the stuff around him, I can do the same thing. So I did it. I switched up my mediums, I slowed down, and I went from this like really dead color versailles, building into more fully rendered flesh, and then really broken, you know, in contrast to the broken background. So I was like playing with that, those ideas in this picture. This one was all done from life, and with Chelsea, I was really interested in the figure-ground relationship, meaning the background color is the same as her, and this is something that Mirandi would do in his still lives. If you guys know who Mirandi was, he was a still life painter, but he would often paint the objects he was painting the same color as the surface he was painting, and he would conscientiously contrive ambiguity, very on purpose, like make it so, you know, what you basically break a rule. You're not supposed to create ambiguous areas, you're supposed to kind of define things. And he would say, forget that, I'm gonna purposely make things disappear from background into form. Our eyes connect the dots. You can leave a ton of stuff out and our eyes will still connect it. So I wanted her to sort of emerge off the background. And on a side note, in the middle of this painting, I painted it with a very, very high spectral palette. Greens, purples, blues, reds, you wouldn't recognize the picture. It was crazy colorful at one point. Again, experimenting to see what would happen, and then I ended up just rendering it back down, and then losing as much as I could, but still have it be very solid in its form. So that's an idea, using an artist I love, Mirandi, a still life painter, and take Mirandi into the figurative world. All right, I'm gonna move over here and talk about this guy. Because this one is probably the most ambitious painting I've ever done. It's not the biggest by any stretch of the imagination, but it's the most ambitious. It was actually in a class in graduate school. One of my teachers, named Luis Serrano, who's the subject of that painting back there, Luis gave me a prompt, which was to do a painting about the human condition, which has to be like the toughest thing you can possibly attack. Like, oh, just do something about, you know, what it is to be human. Okay. So I think at the time I was dealing with the whatever my own demons are about daily chores and making sure that those have priority as well as the exciting things of life. And I realized, you know, in coming to it, I was gonna paint this picture of myself doing dishes as the sort of ordinary acts of everyday life that are really what ends up being your life. You know, we skip over these things, but it turns out that is the human condition, is all the stuff that you have to do every day. And if you can't escape it, so you must embrace it. And, you know, it's a Zen sort of way of doing things. Anyways, so the space, the environment is a kitchen in Italy that my wife and I go back year after year to go paint there. It's a residency, so it holds a very creative energy for us. And it's also a time when we're away from all the mundane day-to-day things in our home. We're there and we're focusing only on our art. And I wanted this to be sort of a vanitas. And what vanitas is in the art tradition is ideas of death and life and the fleetingness of life. Do I have that right, all you art people? Vanitas is the fleetingness of life. You know, you too will die. It's a memento mori. And so there's a lot of little symbolisms in here. And I so avoided these things in my painting traditionally. I have no symbolism in these things, like doorway, that's it. Light coming in, that's it. And I just, I had to kind of, again, throw that assumption about this is how I do my paintings. I'll throw that out. Okay, I'm gonna do content, you know, iconography, symbolism. All right, let's do it. So I have, you know, the tipped over wine glass, which is sort of the, what is this tipped over wine glass? It's something about the fleetingness of life again. Like it's, you know, you're gonna be spilled. You're filled one day, you're gonna be dead the next. In the cutting board here, the olive wood cutting board, there's a distorted picture of a skull, which is, you guys, if you look at it from about here, you'll see it. But just trust me, there's a skull in here, which is again, also a reminder of death. And this hallway down here, which is sort of more of my regular subject matter, I started to change the proportions of this to sort of balance out the proportions of the figure. So the hall, this doorway is vastly too tall to be a real door. It's supposed to be the same weight visually as the figure. And then the passage deep through space in my brain was sort of like a passage through life. There's shoes kicked off along the way as your childhood. There's your traveling coat and then maybe your chair that you rest at the end of your life. Up here is a little painting of a Holbein painting of Sister Thomas More. And Thomas More, it gave the quote for the title of the painting, which is Ordinary Acts. And I think the quote is, these ordinary acts which we perform every day have more importance to our soul than we realize. Something like that, I'm paraphrasing. And Holbein, the painter, also did a distorted skull in his ambassador's painting, if you're an artist, if you're not. And then, of course, I love coffee, so I'm washing my Illy coffee cup pot. And then the whole composition is taken, is sort of like a Vermeer composition with a figure in profile looking out to the, from a light coming in from the left. And I love Vermeer, so there's that. But it's all of these concepts that I've never really used. And also there's a running water thing, there's a movement to that, and a kind of auditory sound. You can almost hear what that's gonna sound like, water on a tin sink. And then it also creates a movement because there's actually kind of that flow of water here and then into the painting and back around. This portrait was really, really difficult. There's a little study for it over there that I did as an exercise to kind of get back to this one. This portrait killed me. I didn't have a great reference for it from Italy, and I had to wrestle with it for weeks and weeks back in my studio. But over here, the piece next to it, that's an interior from the same Italian place where we go to paint. And that's what I usually would do, these empty spaces that have a sort of formal compositional meaning, but the content is much more open and left to your, you know, what you want to project on it. These things are much more filled with the human presence, which we know always is loaded with content. You can't get away from it. And then one other piece I'll talk about is the woman holding the cell phone. So this is, I titled this piece Modern Vanity. And as part of my this group of work, I really wanted to see what I would do with the contemporary nude, how I would tackle the nude, the female nude, which is, it's a very kind of, it's one of the oldest tropes in our history, but how to sort of do it, you know, do it with beauty, but not be simply objectification or fashion. You know, I didn't want it to just be like, oh, look at this, you know, beautiful woman. I wanted to sort of spin it a little bit. And so I was thinking about the ideas of narcissism and vanity. And in the traditional sense, this would always be represented with a mirror. You know, like that's a symbol of vanity, is the hand mirror especially. And this is the modern hand mirror, and the symbol of narcissism and vanity is the self-portrait on a cell phone. And it's ubiquitous, and we all have some sort of gut reaction to it these days. And I wanted her, you know, she's a model that has a lot of kind of funky tattoos, and her hair is always shaved here, and a lot of piercings, and her black nail polish. And so I wanted this sort of person who's done all these adornments, these, vanity sort of adornments, tattoos and shaving your hair and earrings, but they're very contemporary, they're very now, and then reflecting a kind of vanity that is only today. So that was my intention with that picture, to sort of create a, I don't know, modern take on a classic idea. Actually, we will talk a little bit about Luis there. I think that's an interesting one. I'm sorry to spin you guys around. Luis, he's a good friend and a, you know, a peer and a mentor back in LA. Fantastic artist. And I always see Luis Serrano as a like a monk, like a monastic figure. He's always scholarly. He always has the best things. He's always been reading some tome on an artist that you barely even know. He's been reading tomes on him. He can come up with these great quotes and great ideas and great things to challenge your assumptions about art. And he is also monastic in how he paints. He draws the same, let's say, still lifes, but mostly trees, little simple landscapes, urban, little copse of trees, and he'll paint these day after day after day, and just, it's a sort of religious sort of way to do it. It's a monastic way to do it. And so I wanted to depict him in a sort of icon-like form with his sketchbook and his notes, and then have nature basically almost overtaking him, impinging from the sides. This is it's an abstracted landscape behind him, a hillside, that is sort of, he's losing the battle between himself and nature. It's a integration and communing with nature. So to me, he's like a spiritual person, and I wanted to make it spiritual just through formal means. That's what I got to go on right now. There's also a painting in the front, Lily, but I don't think I want to make you guys move for it. But the painting in the front, did you get to see the one of the lady lighting the cigarette? Mm-hmm. So that's an interesting painting too. Lily is a filmmaker in LA. Her name's Anna Lily Amrapour, and she's a old friend, and she was in the middle of editing a movie when I went to go see her. So she was sort of like, she gave me the time to sit for me, but she was definitely in work mode, in a crazy creative sort of space. And at first I was gonna have her sort of posing for me, very kind of straightforward. And eventually I decided to change it so she was engaged in an activity. And a lot of these, I wanted these paintings to have someone engaged in an activity, not simply posing for you. And I think when you have someone engaged in an activity as a viewer, it's a bit of an invitation in to sit with them further. If they're looking back at you, it can be a little bit confrontational, but if they're engaged in something, perhaps you get to be invited in a different way, maybe more voyeuristic, but you get to contemplate the figure in a different way. And so I decided to have Lily smoking a cigarette, lighting a cigarette, and just focusing on this little simple action. And behind her was a very simple stoop of her house. There was nothing there. And I decided to open the stoop up and push back and make a invented space behind her, a hallway to a view that didn't exist. None of it existed. And then in time, I overchoked the room with plants and vines and various things to interrupt the space, not have the viewer go out, but realize that this is a recessional space that is clogged, that is lush but not very inviting. And this is sort of like a mental space sometimes. It's lush but it's almost too much. And there's a door with a window through it, and I covered up the window, kind of putting up barriers to moving through this space. And looking at it, you wouldn't necessarily see any of this, but there was a lot of these layers and pushes and scrapes and repaints to try to invent a space that was reflective of the her human experience. And I'd never done anything like that before. I've done formal things, I've invented a few interiors, but never trying to balance it out with a human. And I wanted her to be grounded and solid, and this space be like complete fantasy, you know, an invention. So that was another sort of breakthrough painting for me. Though there's also two pictures over here, the two oversized pictures, two portraits, one of myself and one of my wife, that are bright and colorful. And these were totally different types of paintings for me. They're double life size. They're not naturalistic in color. They're not anything like these pictures. And I think I was trying to all these different ways to approach the portrait, through softer edges, crazier impasto, lost edges, and kind of different palette organizations. Instead of this natural kind of grays and browns, which is so common if you're painting a naturalistic interior, to go for purples and yellows and greens and whatever other colors I felt like indulging. You know, the, the idea of a body of work like this, where you're throwing out your own rules and your own way of working, it's liberating. It's scarier, but it's liberating. You know, the dangers of being an artist with a long career is you start to have ways that you work, and then you start looking at subject matter and seeing how that subject matter will fit into your way of painting. As opposed to going after what you're actually interested in, you start looking for things that will fit a preconceived structure of paintings. Does that make sense? And I think anyone who's painted for a long time with some success has definitely fallen into this. It's something to watch out for. It's not necessarily a trap, but it's something to be aware of. And I think you're looking at this body of work where I was pushing myself in a figurative realm to sort of, you know, question those assumptions. So, are there any questions? Was that too fast? Did I go too fast?
No.
I just like babbled. Like, I have no idea. Sorry, Stephen, behind you. Okay, hold on. I'm actually kind of letting myself be for a second. I'm working on a commission, I'm working on a few pieces, but there's so much now after that couple years of doing a lot of figurative work. I have a ton of sort of half thought through ideas. I have one huge painting that everyone, we joke about it, it's called The Cacophony of Flesh, and it's like 60 figures like twisted all together, because I was like, I gotta try this. And I realized early on that I wouldn't finish it for a while. So that's sitting there in my studio, just like taunting me. I have a few portraits that are, you know, they're not quite done, and I want to go back to them now that I've done all of these and maybe sand them and actually re-go into them. I don't know. One thing I kind of came around to at the end, I ended up titling my thesis Nuance Over Novelty. And I think it was the idea that I kept looking for the new thing, what's going to be the thing, of squeegees and scraping and crazy whatevers. In the end, I felt like these little subtle turns of flesh, subtle nuanced stuff, was of more satisfaction. And I think my background coming up, I was much more interested in like Diebenkorn and Matisse, and then came into, and I love Vermeer, so I wanted to kind of jam Diebenkorn and Vermeer together and create sort of bold paintings about really subtle color ideas and values and natural light. And now it's like this sub, and I wouldn't allow myself to render things slowly. It would always be bold and choppy. And now I've gone into this realm where I'm just excited about those little subtle turns. And a lot of people start the other way. They start out rendering things really tight and they try their entire life to loosen up. Not my problem. My problem's the opposite way. I'm loose, I'm plenty loose. I can be as loose as you want. And I'm fascinated now, especially when it comes to flesh around the face. The subtleties are incalculable. You know, we have huge part of our brain is designed around this, recognizing this. So it's like, it's endlessly interesting what you can do. So that's kind of where I'm excited about what my next body of work will look like. I'm not sure. But I think I'll still want to travel and paint spaces. They'll always be interesting to me. But then this is also interesting. So, doesn't really answer your question.
But
arriving at the self-realization that it's okay to not have to reinvent a crazy new style, but literally to maybe just go deeper and more narrow might be a fun place to be for a while. I think that's, Steve.
You definitely scored a lot of points with that stovetop espresso maker.
Yes.
Here in Seattle.
Yes. And you can tell I'm taking it apart. I've already had coffee. I'm going to wash it.
I actually have one myself. I love that little
guy.
So congratulations again on your MFA.
Thanks.
I know a lot of the instructors there at the school, and your focus was portraits, but was there other things that you gained from different artists, like in your rooms, your still lifes? Definitely have seen a jump up in your work.
I don't know, like this still life over here is a little different than I would normally do. It was actually done while in a class, and it was a more ambitious still life than I would normally attack. And for me, there's all these optical things in this that I was having a ton of fun with. The stovetop espresso machine turns out to be this amazing color reflector. So what we have is, in the above this line, almost the entire picture is blue and white, except for here, where I can reflect the oranges, yellows, and whites of the other parts of the picture. And then, of also importance was, often I use darks to move your eye around the picture, and you'll see like little crackling darks that will sort of move you around. And in this case, I wanted the whites to move you around. So this orchid, I don't think was there. I don't think that, you know, I move things around, change things in order to direct your eye. That's how I'm moving you around, just the whites. That's a different thing for me. I'm a formal painter by nature. So I want to solve this aspect of it, the picture plane, and how we move our eye around it. And what's fun about painting the interior spaces is it's all this internal geometry, and then there's this deep space. So you don't just move around the picture this way, but you move around the picture this way. And that's actually a really fun place to play with perception and how you experience the space, because you get to kind of march around and have a little fun time. Excuse me, any other questions?
Please, don't be shy.
Kenny.
Yes.
Would you say that what you just described is how you actually played off and mastered the way of light? Because when I look at your paintings, there's a lot of great control on how I look at your work just because of the way you lit it. Would you say that that has been a big influence for you in the way you put together a piece because of the light? I look at the hallway, I look at the composition, and I'm actually being drawn by your narrative simply because of the way you lay out light.
Light is integral to the subject matter. So if you said, I have this great house, I want you to paint my house, I have this great room, it's so great. It is only a great room to paint if the light is good. The most beautiful room with all these cool artifacts in it, if the light's not right, it's horrific. It makes me have zero interest in painting it. And it's usually indirect raking light. That's usually what I like. Not sunlight bouncing off the ground, but that indirect Seattle-style light with all gray, you know, filtering in. That's what I love. Even if I'm in Cuba, that's the light I'm going to seek out, is indirect light like that falling. It sort of evokes form. Like you'll see it in the shoes or something. That's an indirect light turns the form, and in contrast, a really mundane subject, awful subject matter. Corner of a trash bin, but the light's right on it, great painting. It'll be a great painting. And the thing is, with a picture like this, there's another aspect of this painting which is kind of funny for you artists out there. There are two vanishing points to this picture. There's the left side and the right side, and they vanish at different points. Over here, all these things merge to about my chest. The right side of the picture, they merge about here. And I wanted this vanishing point to be out of view of this side of the picture, so you're moving around through space to some unseen point back there. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And the light kind of coming in is sort of, you know, that's pulling you in, like you're saying. The idea is that you want to seek out that unknown light source. You assume there's a window or door or something there. But you don't have to show it. You can just reflect it. But yeah, there's so many formal concerns in doing a picture like these. When I'm doing a straight interior, the geometry is much more easy. I can just move things and change things. I'm very sort of gung-ho about that. But with things like figures, it's trickier. It makes it 100 times more complicated, especially not just a figure, but a portrait. Likeness and accuracy, it gets really, really, really challenging. So these are not just like doing a portrait, like doing a figure in an environment is much, much, much trickier because we're reading it on a lot of different levels at once. Yeah. Anything else? Kwan, I know you have questions. Yes?
Well, we all know faces.
Yes.
And we also know if something's a little bit off.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. Immediately.
Immediately.
Yeah, it's hard. And every single one of these portraits was done differently. I don't have a method. Sometimes I'd be like working on drawings and transferring the drawings. Sometimes I'd be painting from life. Sometimes I'd take a photograph, transfer it, do a drawing, paint it, sketch it up, transfer it. Like, every single one was different. I didn't have a set method because I'm still figuring it out. Everyone's different. That's kind of fun. Like, it's... I mean, it wasn't exactly fun doing it. It was kind of like maddening, but artwork is work, you know? It's not always fun, but I think giving myself these 2 years to not try to get a show together, not try to crank on a deadline for an exhibition, I knew I could paint fast enough to get the work done, and I'm really happy that Elena, agreed to show the work and have these exhibited together. It makes me very happy. And then, to see some of the interior spaces with them. To me, it's the first time I've ever seen this, so I'm kind of, I'm happy with it. I wasn't sure if it would work. Yes?
I'm just curious about your commissions. Can you tell us about what you're doing?
Oh, right now, the commissions? A really good designer in LA commissioned me to do a few of these interior spaces, so I'm just doing those for them. It's trying to keep myself, you know, playing with materials and different ways to do it, you know, the same thing, trying to keep my brain in it. I've been doing these interior spaces for, since 2002, really, like, you know, exhibiting them, and I love it because it allows me to travel and experience the world through paint, you know, and I've done these shows based on, you know, France and Italy and China and UK and Cuba, Buenos Aires, Peru, Taipei. So that's
primarily interiors.
Some cityscapes. I like cityscapes as well, but the interiors are they're easier onto me. Like, I see them better. Like, I understand them better, and so I can figure out how to fix the problems better sometimes. Whereas cityscapes, some people are dedicated cityscape painters, and I do it when I move to do it, but it's not my thing usually. What else? Anything else? Is that good? Has everyone had enough?
Okay. That's great.
I can keep babbling.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
I have a question.
Yeah, what's that?
Well, first, I'm sure everybody here agrees with me that it's a delight to see. We've all loved your interior work for so long, but to see somebody who can do non-figurative work on the level that you do it, who can then also do figurative work so beautifully. I mean, you're hitting 1,000 in all the categories, and that's wonderful. It's great. In your interiors, you get this wonderful liveliness, and I imagine some of that's coming from the alternating warm, cool, warm, cool, but also all these lovely layers and the sculptural effects you've got perhaps with a palette knife.
Tons of palette knife.
Okay. Could you give us an idea of this section here of your self-portrait, the floor area? How many layers do you think that would be?
Sometimes it's just two or three.
Okay.
You can, if you look closely, you can see underpainting through some of these areas. You can see it sort of glows underneath. Sometimes there are more, but there's. I found that the palette knife for flat reflective surfaces can emulate how light actually moves across it because of the nature of the tool and the mark I can make and how it catches light. Because the way we perceive everything around us is light bounces off and bounces into your eyeball, and if you can make paint sort of do a certain effect, it kind of emulates the same effect. So so that the carpet will feel different than the floor next to it, even though they might be the same color. And I've been doing that for a while. I love doing it, and it's never easy. I said it was easy, that's wrong, actually, I forget. I forget. It's actually never easy, but eventually I know I can wrestle it into something that looks right. But like, let's say this big Cuban painting back here, this one started extremely colorful. This was, I think I did this somewhere in the middle of the graduate program, and I was like, well, I'm gonna do crazy color on this one, and it was like fluorescent green and chartreuse and bright phthalo blue, colors I never touch. I never touch a phthalo blue. Crazy colors all over it, and then again, I sort of wrestled it back into sort of this gray naturalistic image. But if you look around, you poke around there, you'll see some weird colors. But in the end, it doesn't really matter. It's all gonna arrive at the same place. Some people don't believe in using all the dead earth colors. I say it's all what you do with them. It's not about what color you're using.
Easier said than done.
I'm saying it.
Make it look easy.
Yeah, exactly. But, yeah. Hope that answered the question. Yeah, a lot of knife, a lot of palette knife. All right, last question.
Well, I'm always curious about artists thinking in terms of title, how they come up with titles. Ah. Yours seem to be fairly just basic descriptive. Do you see them that way?
Titles are always horribly basically descriptive. It's like chair with rug, you know, room number two. These ones, Ordinary Acts, that's different. You know, like that actually has a meaning. There's a modern vanity. There's loaded meaning in it, but only if I need it. Often if it's about a portrait, I'm gonna call it Nara, I'm gonna call it Luis. But usually titles aren't my thing. And often I want the reader to kind of read into it how they want. I've seen good titles. My wife Judy makes great titles. I mean, they're beautiful, they're poetic, and they're interesting, and I was like, oh, I wish I did that. But it honestly, it just doesn't, it's something that I love in other people's work, I just don't do it. I don't know why. That's all. All right, well, I'm gonna wrap it up.
Yeah.
Thanks.